Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Dr. Janet Roman. I'm the director of the University of South Florida Doctor Nursing Practice Program. Although we are disappointed that we're not holding this ceremony in person, we are so pleased that you were able to join us today. These past several months have been challenging for everyone, and we appreciate the flexibility and innovation that our students and faculty have demonstrated.
Welcome to the University of South Florida College of Nursing Doctoral Celebration. I'm Usha Menon, Interim Dean of the College of Nursing. Thank you all for tuning in on this very special occasion. Today we're celebrating the graduation of 12 Doctor of Nursing Practice students and 2 PhD in Nursing Science students. For those of you earning your doctoral degrees today, what a milestone this is for you. For those family and friends who are watching, thank you for supporting our students on their journey. They could not have done this without you. This is an extraordinary time to graduate. The country, and indeed the world, has changed in ways we never expected. As nurses, we've been in the forefront of this global pandemic in many different ways. While many of you are already in the healthcare system working, you are now armed with the skills to advance science, to implement new systems, and influence policy. There will be new opportunities and new challenges, and we wish you the very best as you enter the world with your enhanced skills and knowledge. Seize the initiative to make a difference where it counts the most for the health of our communities, the nation, and the world. And remember that as nurses, we respect diversity and we promote inclusive excellence. Be safe and well. The USF College of Nursing is a part of USF Health in conjunction with the Colleges of Medicine, Public Health, and the Taneja College of Pharmacy, and the School of Biomedical Sciences and the School of Physical Therapy and Rehabilitation Sciences. Accredited by the Commission on the Collegiate Nursing Education and founded in 1973, the College of Nursing offers bachelor's, master's, and doctoral degrees in nursing. The mission of the college is to provide innovation and leadership in preparing 21st century nurses to demonstrate excellence in research, education, and clinical care while promoting health and wellness in our community and around the world. We at the College of Nursing pride ourselves in educating nurses who are ready to make an impact on healthcare both locally and around the globe. We are honored to have played a part in helping you reach this important day. Congratulations on your success. Go Bulls!
Congratulations to our 2020 PhD and Doctor of Nurse Practitioner graduates. Earning a doctoral degree is an extraordinary accomplishment, and each of you should take great pride in reaching this day. I know I speak for all of us at USF Health when I say that we could not be prouder of you. Over the course of your careers, your work in research and/or clinical evidence-based strategies will have a lasting impact on countless patients. It has become abundantly clear throughout the last few months that the world needs compassionate healthcare leaders committed to scientific evidence. This is why USF Health actively promotes interprofessional research and practice. It is imperative in this uncertain era that doctors, nurses, and other healthcare professionals work together to ensure patient safety and our recovery. This global pandemic has presented us with challenges unlike anything in living memory. And each of you, by choosing this path, has a critical role to play in healing our nation. It will not be easy, but your education has prepared you for these difficult times. Wherever your careers take you, please remember you will always have a home with the University of South Florida and USF Health. Congratulations again to the class of 2020.
Hello, I am Marcia Johansson, Director of Adult-Gerontology Acute Care. This year's graduating class is a group of dedicated and talented healthcare professionals. One outstanding example is Lanette Dumas. She completed her PhD dissertation this semester entitled A Phenomenologic Study of Post-Extubation Patients, What Are the Preferred Methods of Communication During Their Experience of Endotracheal Intubation with Mechanical Ventilation. We are pleased that she is speaking to all of us today to provide some perspective about the journey she experienced in her program.
Good afternoon. What a wonderful day to be here to celebrate our achievements. Congratulations. I know with the advent of COVID-19, for so many of us, these past few months have been fraught with anxiety and uncertainty. Our lives have been turned upside down, and how we've had to adapt and interact with others has changed. But we're here, and more importantly, each of us have accomplished a major milestone in our lives, our doctorates. So that's just wonderful to be able to celebrate this during this time. Before I begin, I would like to recognize the University of South Florida's College of Nursing esteemed faculty. I believe I can speak for all the graduates when I say we would not be here without your support. Thank you. I would also like to especially acknowledge the doctoral faculty and staff who have put together this amazing celebration. It's just wonderful that we are able to celebrate this time in our lives. And lastly, and probably most importantly, I would like to thank our families and friends and mentors outside of academia. I know personally I wouldn't be here again without all the love and support that I have received. Even if some of my friends, and especially my mother, still don't understand what my dissertation is, or more importantly, why it took me so long to finish. But I'm here and they're happy and they're celebrating with me. It's an honor to speak to this audience today. I was quite frankly a little surprised and very shocked when I had been asked to speak. I actually thought it was a mistake, and then I thought perhaps I am the only one graduating this semester. But after verifying it with Marissa Kearney, I said yes without thinking about it. And that's really how I began my doctorate journey. I was finishing up my master's in nursing education, and I was given this great opportunity to pursue my doctorate at University of South Florida. For once, I didn't belabor the point. I didn't make a do or not to do list. I didn't worry about finances, how I was going to juggle family life, work life, trying to fit in school through all this. I just, really had to put all of those uncertainties and anxieties to the side. I, of course, one of my biggest obstacles was, truthfully, was I going to be smart enough to even pursue a doctorate? But as one of my very dear friends put it so succinctly, I'm doing this because I could. I was given this great opportunity. So my doctoral journey has been very interesting, as probably everyone else's has been. As Jerry Garcia of The Grateful Dead has succinctly put it, what a long, strange trip it's been. I started in January of 2016 with really no idea of what I was doing. All I knew is that I wanted to impact nursing, and for me, that's critical care. I've been a nurse for 20 years. A majority of that time has been spent in critical care, and I knew that this was one area that sorely needed nursing research to be able to hopefully impact care, to make sure that we're able to do research in this field. So I started out as a graduate assistant for Dr. Cindy Monroe. Her field of research was very similar to mine, so she was my first advisor. Then Dr. Monroe was given an incredible opportunity at the University of Miami, which she decided to pursue. But before she left, she had mentioned just this one little quote that has kind of stayed with me. If it frightens you, then it excites you. Just do it. So I plodded along. I was still really trying to come up with this groundbreaking dissertation research area in critical care, but I was also interested in communication within the critical care field. Then during one of my research opportunities, I was able to do a dissertation elective with Dr. Carmen Rodriguez. Again, her research interests and mine somewhat intersect. We're both interested in communication with those patients that are no longer or temporarily unable to speak. So it was during that time that I really felt invigorated, felt really happy, felt that I was contributing in some way to nursing research. So meanwhile, Dr. John Clossy became my second advisor, and Dr. Clossy was exactly who I needed at this point in my journey. He had extensive critical care background, he listened to what I wanted to do, and he told me this is what we're going to do. He said we're going to do a qualitative dissertation, and this is who's going to be on your committee. And I liked that about Dr. Clossy because coming from that critical care background, sometimes you have to make those decisions. Sometimes things are black and white. So I found that suited me very well. So I had never taken a qualitative course. So I took one that summer and I found myself with a group of anthropology students, and it was a fantastic course. Again, opportunities come up. I had also taken a grant writing course with Dr. Cecile Leniger, and I was the only nursing student in that course either. I was there with public health students. And those two classes were just very eye-opening. I was able to see so much new research being developed. Some of these students, these doctoral students, were doing research in Africa or in the Caribbean. They were working with people who had lost loved ones, who had tried to cross over to the border from Mexico. They were working with the FBI trying to identify remains. It was just phenomenal work that so many of them were doing. And also, I guess more importantly for me, when I would share my research and give presentations during this time, I got a lot of feedback from them as to what would work well, what they didn't understand, maybe how I could tweak it. So that was a great opportunity. So during this time, Dr. Clossy left USF for another great opportunity. But of course, before he leaves, he gave me some great advice, which of course I never wanted to listen to, but he told me that my dissertation was going to take as long as it takes. Now, I had set a definitive timetable as to when my dissertation was going to be done. That timetable came and it went. So then I was with my third advisor, Dr. Denise Passmore, who was on my dissertation committee. And again, it's meeting those right people at the right time in my dissertation journey. So Dr. Passmore was an education English professor in the College of Nursing, and she did a lot of research with many of the nursing faculty, and she was a qualitative researcher. So she really helped facilitate and get me prepared for my committee to sign off for me to do my dissertation research. So then I get ready to do my research. And it took me 9 months to get IRB approval from Tampa General Hospital and the University of South Florida. Now, during this time, I tried not to compare myself to some of my colleagues that were behind me at the time who were already getting ready to defend their dissertation. And of course there was the group before me who many of them had been out for quite a couple months. So I learned patience during this time and to kind of take it as it comes. This time to me though was invaluable. It really taught me how to submit to an IRB. I learned how to do an amendment, and I also learned how to do submission or resubmission. And I also learned, probably most importantly, why researchers apply for grants continually. I guess I was under this naive impression that every single time I would send in a grant or something to the IRB for research, it really wouldn't take that long. It takes long. So I understand that now, and that was an appreciation that I could not have learned taking a course. It was something that I had to learn by myself, with, of course, my faculty mentors helping me along the way. But also during this time, it was very isolating, and it was very insular for me. I wasn't taking any classes. I wasn't at the campus. I was working during this time, just kind of waiting, resubmitting, doing what I needed to do to get my study approved. And it was also during this time that Dr. Passmore decided to retire. But she left me again with a great opportunity and great advice. Talk to Dr. Victoria Marshall regarding your research. I really think that she would be a good fit with you. So I did. And Dr. Victoria Marshall, along with Dr. Constance Visovsky, became my final co-chairs. I really do have to mention my wonderful advisor, Dr. Marshall. Again, it's one of those instances where I really wish she could have been with me at the beginning of my journey, but the outcome may not have been the same for me. She was there when I needed her. Her support and encouragement were phenomenal. She got me to where I needed to be, and her support was just something that I can't adequately describe. But she's truly just a great role model, as well as a mentor for me. And she wasn't so far removed from experiencing everything that I was experiencing myself. So that was just wonderful to be able to talk to someone who understood where I came from and where I was now in my life. So I was able to successfully defend my dissertation. And now I just have so many opportunities. I have opportunities to publish, I have opportunities to present my research, and also to try to find a job in academia, which is where I would ultimately love to end up. But as I said before, my journey isn't everyone's. I learned a lot about myself. Most importantly for me, it's to persevere. I couldn't always look at the whole picture at times. It was sometimes very overwhelming to me, but it was my determination that really saw me through. I knew I could handle this little block of this stumbling block just a little bit at a time. I couldn't overthink things or look too far in the future. So the best summation of my journey is from a Canadian author, Barry Finley. He was an accountant and actually worked for the Canadian government in different roles at various times. And he wrote a book called Kilimanjaro and Beyond, A Life-Changing Journey. And his quote has stayed with me through a majority of my dissertation journey. He said, every mountain is within reach if you just keep climbing. So that is what I intend to do, is just keep climbing. Thank you very much for allowing me to share my journey with you. And again, congratulations to all the new doctoral students. Well, I guess we're not students anymore, but thank you so much for allowing me to share in this celebration.
Hello, I'm Theresa Beckie, Associate Dean of the PhD program in Nursing Science. Students who earn a PhD from this program can affect the lives of millions of people by creating the science that impacts patients, families, and communities. During this past semester, two of our talented students have successfully defended their dissertations and earned their PhDs. We have invited them to share their work with you today, and I hope you'll watch their presentations, which appear later in this celebration.
Hello, I am Denise Maguire, the Vice Dean of Graduate Programs. Congratulations to all our graduating doctoral students. In recent weeks, our DNP students completed their final projects and presented posters that summarized their work. The other judges and I reviewed their presentations and I am pleased to announce the winners of the first, second, and third place. I invite you to watch their presentations as well, which will be shown later in the celebration. Placing third for her presentation on the impact of telephone follow-up post-discharge in cardiac surgical patients is Jenna Morrison. Placing second for his presentation on a team-based follow-up protocol to improve blood pressure control is Kenneth Argote. And placing first for her presentation on reducing antibiotic use in elderly for suspected urinary tract infections in long-term care is Osteel Peck. Congratulations to all our winners.
Hello, I'm Tracey Taylor, Associate Dean of the Graduate Clinical Programs at the USF College of Nursing. Although we are not able to have an official commencement ceremony this semester, I want to congratulate you all on earning your doctoral hoods. You may wonder where the tradition of hooding came from, so I'll provide a little background. The hooding ceremony is believed to have originated in European universities in the 12th century. The ceremony was a way to recognize graduating students as they began their scholarly careers. Hooded robes were often required for warmth in unheated medieval libraries, and now they're mostly symbolic. Universities eventually differentiated students by their academic majors, and colors were added as accents to robes and hoods to signify these distinctions. The color for the nursing profession is apricot. As you can see here on my hood, this is the detail in apricot velvet that surrounds the outside. On the inside of the doctoral hood, you will see the colors of your alma mater. So the inside of your hoods will have USF full colors. Today, wearing a hood represents a commitment to scholarly life. I encourage you to cherish your doctoral hood as I do mine. I hope it will inspire you all to become lifelong learners.
Good afternoon. I'm Brittany Hay, Director of the Adult-Gerontology Primary Care Concentration. It's a pleasure to share the names of our candidates and the titles of their doctoral projects. Kenneth Argote, a team-based follow-up protocol to improve blood pressure control. Project faculty, Dr. Janet Roman. Danielle Carrera, a quality improvement initiative for non-pharmacological therapy in dementia. Project faculty, Dr. Marcia Johansson. Cassie Hazen, improving utilization of the patient health questionnaire, PHQ-9, in the management of major depressive disorder in primary care. Project faculty, Dr. Marcia Johansson. Rizwana Ismail, a retrospective review of the impact of technology-based interventions on immunization rates among Generation Z college students. Project faculty, Dr. Brittany Hay. Arlene Lang, fall prevention in adults 65 years and older in a long-term care facility. Project faculty, Dr. Janet Roman. Elizabeth Miller, blood pressure self-management with the commercial truck driver. Project faculty, Dr. Marcia Johansson. Jenna Morrison, impact of telephone follow-up post-discharge in cardiac surgery patients. Project faculty, Dr. Marcia Johansson. Eugenie Newby Steffen, expanding and updating the Pinellas Hope Medical Clinic. Project faculty, Dr. Marcia Johansson. Osteel Peck, reducing antibiotic use in elderly for suspected urinary tract infections in long-term care. Project faculty, Dr. Janet Roman and Dr. Candace Burns. Kelly Peterson, fast and focused, improving point-of-care ultrasound competencies for advanced practice registered nurses. Project faculty, Dr. Marcia Johansson. Alicia Piazza, first aid asthma protocol at the Florida Department of Juvenile Justice. Project faculty, Dr. Marcia Johansson. Megan Poe, first case on-time starts and professionalism. Project faculty, Dr. Michelle Canali. Lanette Dumas, a phenomenologic study of post-extubated patients. What are the preferred methods of communication during their experience of endotracheal intubation with mechanical ventilation? Co-major professor, Dr. Constance Visovsky. Co-major professor, Dr. Victoria Marshall. Jennifer Miller, predictors of non-adherence to radiation therapy schedules among head and neck cancer patients. Major professor, Dr. Carmen Rodriguez. Congratulations to all of you.
Hello everyone, I'm Tina Bricker, director of the Family Nurse Practitioner Primary Care Concentration. At this time, I invite all our graduates and any other nurses who are watching to stand and read the International Council of Nurses Pledge. In full knowledge of the obligations I am undertaking, I promise to care for the sick with all the skills and understanding I possess without regard to race, creed, color, politics, or social status, sparing no effort to conserve life, to alleviate suffering, and to promote health. I will respect at all times the dignity and religious beliefs of the patients under my care, holding in confidence all personal information entrusted to me, and refraining from any action that might endanger life or health. I will endeavor to keep my professional knowledge and skill at the highest level, and to give loyal support and cooperation to all members of the health team. I will do my utmost to honor the International Code of Nursing Ethics, and to uphold the integrity of the professional nurse.
Before we conclude this special occasion, we want to take a moment to thank all of the people who made it possible. Please watch the credits at the end of this video as we recognize everyone who worked behind the scenes to record the video clips and to organize this virtual event. To our graduates, you are now alumni of the USF College of Nursing and will always be a part of our family. Remember that the Alumni Society is here to support you. We offer you opportunities for networking, participating in community events, and a place to continue your relationship with your alma mater. In the coming days, you will each receive by mail a medal that marks your achievement as a doctoral graduate. The medals are given to you through a generous contribution by Sigma Theta Tau International via the local chapter of Delta Beta Chapter at Large. We are grateful for their ongoing support of our Bull Nurse doctoral graduates. In that same package will be a printed program from today's event, as well as award certificates for the poster presentation winners. We hope these items will help you commemorate this special occasion. As we close this ceremony, remember that there are many powerful experiences ahead of you, whether you are in clinical practice, administration, academia, or a private endeavor, you are the next generation of nursing leaders. Thank you for joining us today. We all wish you the very best.
Good evening. My name is Ostel Peck. I'm a DNP student. The title of my project is Reducing Antibiotic Use in the Elderly with Suspected Urinary Tract Infection in the Long-Term Care Setting. I chose this project because during my years of practice, I witnessed some elderly that have been over-treated with antibiotics for UTI that's sometimes unnecessary. The intent of this project is to reduce antibiotic use by improving the quality of UTI-related information communicated between staff and providers while using a SBAR and a PDSA model. The SBAR stands for Situation, Background, Assessment, and Request from the Provider when there is an order. This project explores current antibiotics practice and implemented an SBAR tool to combat antibiotics overuse. The nursing theory that I use is the Lipid, White, and Wesley Plane Change model, which focuses on communication skills, problem solving, and establishing feedback processes. The quality improvement model was the PDSA, which stands for Plan, Do, Study, and Act. As method, I did a retrospective chart review on 100 patients. Using that SBAR tool as instrument for nurses to fill out prior calling the providers when suspected UTI. This project took place at a rehab center in the US. For implementation, it got two phases. The first phase is meeting with staff and stakeholders, and a letter was sent to all providers about requesting the forms when getting a call from nurses for suspected UTI. And the nurses and nursing assistant all was educated on UTI symptoms, how to use the SBAR tool, and how to claim this patient prior obtaining a specimen. The second phase is the implementation, using SBAR tools as the pre and post end project. And when we do the analysis of the numbers and the pre-project, the urine analysis is 58 and the post is 34. And for antibiotics is 51 and post end project is 30. And using the mean and standard deviation calculation and using the t-test to compare pre and post project, results indicate a decrease in urinalysis and antibiotics. That means results show that use of evidence-based communication tool can reduce unnecessary antibiotics and urinalysis testing in the long-term care setting. This result is statistically significant at p less than 0.05. This number looking okay and great and very significant, but there is some limitation I need to highlight on that. And the center, the infectious control was working on decreasing the UTI rate that they have at the center. And second, the timing, the project timing was not enough to basically use that numbers. We need about like 3 to 6 months to use that tools to know for fact the numbers is relevant. And the, with the pandemic, so there is many hospitalization and the census dropped considerably. So there is less focuses on UTI and symptoms. And family does not visit it anymore like they used to. So usually family has the one requested for UTI, for urinalysis, for antibiotics, for the change on their loved ones. So because of all this reason, so we, I believe then we need to have like more time at the center to kind of using that tool for 3 to 6 months to conclude that it's a benefit. But sustainability, it's very sustainable because there is no additional cost to it. And when you calculate the drop in urinalysis and antibiotics, when we times that by the price of each one, it's equal to about like 9,000 and plus per year as savings. A center wants to improve the UTI rate, so they know for a fact they will use anything that's working for them. In summary, I believe the SBAR tool can help with the antibiotics overuse. The center will benefit of that, but we need more time to kind of use it to make sure there is no pandemic and everything go back to normal to conclude that it's really feasible. As a nurse practitioner, more work to do with this issue. We need to teach staff about urinary infection and about the effects of the antibiotics overuse to conclude to antibiotic resistance. So we need to involve multidisciplinary team to use the best practice to treat UTI. And my project, thank you.
Hello, everyone. My name is Kenneth Argote, and I want to present my poster presentation today. My project was called A Team-Based Follow-Up Protocol to Improve Blood Pressure Control. When I did the needs assessment at the clinical site where I was at, I saw that we had a big need for improvement in blood pressure control. Blood pressure control continues to be an issue in our nation that is a big cause of death, comorbidity, and economic burden. A stat that really stood out to me was by the CDC that said that out of all the patients diagnosed with hypertension, less than 50% of the patients were at a controlled state. And within the last 10 years, there has been little significant improvement to that. So I saw that we had a problem. Our clinic itself had a average of in 2019 of 63% controlled, and which was better than national average, but still needed a lot of improvement. What was the overall purpose of the project? The overall purpose was to improve this blood pressure control, specifically in a community care, primary care facility. And we know that improving blood pressure control will improve and decrease morbidity and mortality in our patients. I had the clinical question that I asked was, does implementation of a hypertension follow-up protocol that incorporates a two-week patient follow-up with the staff nurse for patients with uncontrolled blood pressure improve blood pressure control in a community-based primary care health center within 8 weeks? When I sat down and did the needs assessment with the clinical site, they were using the PDSA, so I followed that, and I just we did the plan, do, study, act cycle for the model. I used the health promotion model designed by Nola Pender as my nursing theory to guide the project, which she talked about behavioral changes in a patient that lead to improved health outcomes and nurse actions that improve health outcomes. So I incorporated that into the intervention. The methods were pretty straightforward. Every single patient that came into my clinic within those 8 weeks that had a diagnosis of hypertension according to the HEDIS guidelines, HEDIS being the healthcare effectiveness data and information set, was included. Exclusions included chronic kidney disease, pregnancy, and hospice patients. This was done at an FQHC center, federally qualified health center, community health center in Tampa. And the instrument that we used to measure the outcomes was the HEDIS controlling blood pressure scores that were provided to us by the clinical site. The intervention that was done was the implementation of a protocol, an evidence-based protocol that was for uncontrolled hypertension patients. We used a team-based approach, which incorporated a two-week follow-up with a staff nurse. During the visit with the provider, we made sure that the provider handed out hypertension education to every single one of the patients that included behavior modifications and just general hypertension information. A blood pressure log also was given to the patient at the time of the visit, and they were instructed to how to properly measure blood pressure and how many times to measure the blood pressure, and to make sure that they brought that into the nurse visit to go over that. The data was collected over 8 weeks. 8 weeks prior, in March and April, is the data that we collected. And then May, June is the post-intervention data that we collected. And as you can see in the results, March and April, we were on average 63%. However, after the implementation of the protocol, there was blood pressure improvement in those 8 weeks by 12%. In May, we almost got to our organizational goal of 80%. We were at 78% in May, and in June, we were at 76% post-intervention. So we see that there was improvement to the HEDIS controlling blood pressure scores after intervention, after this follow-up protocol was placed. The patient response to the nurse follow-ups were very favorable. Out of the 78 visits that were scheduled for the nurse, 56 patients showed up. Sustainability, the project, that was something that was huge, that we want to make sure that it was sustainable. There was no additional budget that was needed to implement this change. Even the education came from the EMR. It was already integrated in the EMR. There was no additional cost to the patient to do a nurse follow-up, which I believe is what caused the high adherence rate. I did go over this, already presented this to the site clinic, and they were very impressed, and they're already thinking about integrating this project to other sites and to continue this throughout the centers. So I'm very happy with the results. I see that there was patient outcome improvement, and I hope that this will make an impact for my patients in the future.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Jenna Morrison, and the title of my DNP project is Implementation of Telephone Follow-up Post-Discharge in Cardiac Surgery Patients. The identified need and problem statement for my project involved addressing readmissions, which can be defined as an unplanned return to the hospital shortly after being discharged from a recent hospitalization. The population of particular interest is coronary artery bypass graft surgery patients due to their high readmission rates and mean hospital charges. Readmission rates for CABG surgery range from 8.1 to 21.1%. The annual cost to Medicare for potentially preventable CABG readmission is $151 million. These escalating healthcare costs prompted interest in the various components responsible for early 30-day readmissions to hospitals, as well as interventions to help reduce the preventable incidents. Therefore, the purpose of the Quality Improvement Project is to implement telephone follow-up post-discharge to improve transition of care and readmission rates in post-cardiac surgical patients. The nursing theory that was applicable to my project was Maslow's hierarchy of needs. Application of this nursing theory, along with emphasis on improving patient self-care capacity, both must be prioritized during the hospital stay and even when they are discharged home in order to reduce the incidence of readmission. So for my project, for my methods, the project followed a quantitative experimental design. My sampling inclusion comprised of isolated CABG procedure, ages 50 and older, English speaking, alert and oriented, discharged home, as well as telephone access. The intervention consisted of a telephone follow-up post-discharge at 48 to 72 hours, and again at 30 days, that was a part of the Agency for Healthcare Research and Quality Red Toolkit. Components of the toolkit included health status, medication reconciliation, case management needs, follow-up appointments, and plans for what to do if a problem arises. The project measured two outcomes, readmission rates, as well as transition of care, which comprised of three measures: primary care provider appointments, patient knowledge for self-management, and patient satisfaction. For data collection, it included self-reporting survey via phone interviews, which was conducted by me, the primary investigator, as well as medical record review. So briefly, just to go over my results, of the 30 participants, 27, 90% were male, and 3, 10% were female. The mean age was 67.37, with a standard deviation of 8.342. Mean BMI was 30.84, with a standard deviation of 5.687. So I did have two tables. I have a medical record review results that look at readmission rates, as well as my transition of care, which were self-reporting outcomes. Just to break down the importance of my results, which you guys can see on the poster afterwards, in comparison to the 3 months prior in the office where I conducted my project, readmission rates improved by 7.2% after the implementation of telephone follow-up post-discharge. Attention to primary care provider appointments and follow-up, knowledge for self-management of disease and patient satisfaction was completed with each individual patient to achieve successful patient outcomes. I wasn't sure that you guys couldn't see it, but basically my results showed anywhere from 93 to 98% on a yes to no in addressing transition of care for these patients. Implications for advanced practice nursing. So as a DNP prepared APRN, we are capable of translating research into evidence-based practice and driving change within an organization with aims of improving patient outcomes. Overall, the project experience was very rewarding and attributed advanced leadership skills and clinical expertise and signified the purpose and reputation of being a DNP prepared nurse practitioner. For sustainability, given the success, the site where the quality improvement project was implemented is interested in continuing the intervention. I also am very fortunate enough to have earned a full-time position to work as an NP for this group in their outpatient office. And then a quick acknowledgement, I just want to say a special thank you to Dr. Johansson, as well as Dr. Wang, who is my statistician, for their guidance and support throughout the development of my project. I was very fortunate to complete the project amidst the COVID outbreak.
Hello, my name is Lanette Dumas, and I'm here to talk about my dissertation. I did a qualitative study on patients post-extubated who had been endotracheally intubated and were on mechanical ventilation. I was looking at their preferred method of communication during this time. Literature and research to date showed how these patients felt and what they wanted to communicate, but there was no literature that supported how these patients would prefer to communicate while they were unable to speak. I was able to interview 27 participants at Tampa General Hospital in their 8 ICUs that they have there. The data that I collected was also descriptive statistics, as well as interviews that lasted anywhere from 20 to 30 minutes. I asked patients how they were able to communicate during this time while they were unable to speak, and also what methods they would have preferred to use if they had been given any tools or choices. My findings showed that there were 3 major sub-themes: the physical experience, the emotional experience, and their communication experience. The physical experience of being intubated included dry mouth, sore throat, as well as being physically restrained. The emotional experience included fear, anxiety, anger, feelings of incarceration. When I went to my 3rd theme, which was communication, patients told me how they attempted to communicate. Many used body language, some attempted to write, but none were given tools with which to communicate with by the nurses. Many again felt frustrated because they were unable to voice or try to question what was occurring to them. Overall, the majority of my patients that I interviewed stated technology would be the preferred method of communication. Patients enjoyed the freedom that technology would have given them. Many cited being able to use a tablet as the best way because they're able to hold it, and also the adaptability of using a tablet. They're able to type, they're able to write using a stylet, as well as some suggestions of having an alphabet board or also having drop-down boxes where you could pick a letter of the alphabet and a series of words would come out, would show up, where they were able to choose if they needed anything. Also, simple questions of where am I, what the day is, what happened, or I'm thirsty, I need to urinate, why am I tied down, were some of the suggestions that participants had given to me. For future recommendations and future research, I personally would like to try to develop an application along with perhaps using an occupational therapist as well as a computer scientist to help me develop an application for ease of use with these patients so that they can better communicate with their families and friends and doctors. Thank you very much.
Hi, my name is Jennifer Miller, and I'm graduating this summer with a PhD in nursing science. My dissertation work examined if demographics, clinical characteristics, and physical or psychological symptoms predicted non-adherence to radiation therapy schedules among head and neck cancer patients. I became interested in this topic while working full-time as a nurse at the Radiation Oncology Clinic at Moffitt Cancer Center. I worked closely with these patients, and I became aware of the different struggles they faced to try to attend their demanding treatment schedules. Past research has shown that non-adherence to radiation therapy schedules can have a negative effect on the treatment outcome. Tumor recurrence is more likely to occur when patients miss their radiation appointments. While reviewing the literature, I noted that a few studies had documented that non-adherence was a problem among head and neck cancer patients, ranging from approximately 30 to 50% of patients not following schedules as prescribed. The literature that was available focused mostly on describing the rates of non-adherence and looking at demographics and some clinical characteristics. From my nursing experience, I thought symptoms may also play a role in the patient's absences from treatment, and I designed my dissertation study to address this gap in the literature. My study was a retrospective descriptive study that involved reviewing electronic health records of head and neck cancer patients who received treatment at Moffitt. I reviewed the records and extracted data from 262 patients that received treatment between June 2017 and June 2018. Each patient's appointment record was reviewed and the patient was classified as adherent or non-adherent. The results of my study suggest that non-adherent patients were more likely to be female, be admitted to the cancer center during treatment, and receive outpatient IV hydration during treatment. When I compared the symptom scores of the adherent and non-adherent groups, the results show that non-adherent patients reported higher mean symptom scores on 9 out of 12 symptoms measured weekly over treatment, suggesting this group experienced a higher symptom burden. Finally, I performed logistic regression to examine if any variables were predictors of non-adherence. The model did contain significant predictors of treatment non-adherence. Concurrent chemo and radiation treatment regimens and symptoms of tiredness and depression predicted patients were more likely to be non-adherent. Tumor location at the tongue, spiritual well-being, and constipation actually predicted patients were less likely to be non-adherent. Based on these findings, I would tell oncology nurses that routine screenings for symptoms and distress is supported for this population during treatment, and to consider looking for trends and symptom scores instead of setting a certain screening threshold. Patients who missed appointments consistently reported higher symptom numbers, but the numbers were on average below a 4 out of 10. I hope to build on these results in the future by conducting prospective and mixed method studies to talk to patients about what influences their abilities to attend treatment. I'd like to thank my professors and mentors that educated me and inspired me from a novice PhD student to become Dr. Miller. I'm currently working as an assistant professor of nursing at Bellarmine University in Louisville, Kentucky, and I think the faculty would be happy to know that I'm slotted to teach nursing research in the fall to BSN students. Thank you.